A relationship with the right referral partner could be a game changer for any B2B company. So what if you could reverse engineer these relationships at a moment's notice? Start a podcast, invite potential referral partners to be guests on your show, and grow your referral network faster than ever. Learn more at sweetfishmedia.com.
You're listening to the B2B Growth Show, a podcast dedicated to helping B2B executives achieve explosive growth. Whether you're looking for techniques and strategies or tools and resources, you've come to the right place. I'm James Carberry.
And I'm Jonathan Green.
Let's get into the show. Welcome back to the B2B Growth Show. We are here today with Daniel Miller. He is the marketing director at Benchmark Email. Daniel, how are you doing today?
Doing wonderful. Thank you. How about yourself, James?
I am wonderful as well. So Daniel, today we're going to be talking about the email automations that every business should have. We were talking about them offline, just kind of going over them real briefly. And so I'm excited to get to dive in and chat about them more in depth. But before we do that, I'd love for our listeners to have an understanding of what you and your team are up to at Benchmark Email.
Totally. So Benchmark Email, we are a do-it-yourself email marketing service. We like to empower marketers with intuitive software that, of course, is backed by our practical strategies. So not only do we have the software for you, but we also help you implement it as well.
Love it. And so Daniel, in just jumping right in, we're going to cover six specific email automations in this episode. But before we do that, I want to first kind of touch base on some terminology. And so can you talk to us a little bit about some terminology and that will ultimately feed the rest of our conversation?
Totally. Yeah. When it comes down to automations, you know, there's still a lot of businesses that quite haven't adopted it or they really haven't seen the power of it. And I think a lot of it is focused on, you know, the intimidation of, you know, you see some of those automation schemes and you just see it all set up and it looks like just like somebody took a bunch of spaghetti and just threw it on the wall.
Yeah.
And it's just like a scramble there. And actually, that's not how automation should be done. I always like to give the example to businesses. Think of an automation like a choose your own adventure book. Mm. Remember those type of books that you would read it, you would have choices, you know, like go to page 25 to go through the room and find out what's inside, or go to page 72 to go back the way you came. So that is what you really have to focus on when creating a automation. It's about creating that journey, right? What we call the customer journey. All journeys have a start and an end. And just because it's the end of a journey, that doesn't mean it can't trigger a new journey. Because in marketing, there is never an end, right? We want our customers to keep coming back and to bring their friends. So, you know, when it comes down to the terminology of the overall journeys, we like to say that there's an entry point or a trigger where automation begins. Then you follow that with actions and conditions. Actions can be, you know, moving someone from one list to another or sending an email. And the conditions is what focus on, you know, did they open your email? Did they click on a link? Did they go to a website? So combining those three simple things, you can create very, very powerful automations that can not only save you time for your business, but can also increase your return on investment.
Got it. And just so I'm understanding this correctly, Daniel, are these automations, are they coming from kind of your inbox? Like they you can see them like in your sent folder of Gmail, or are these coming from a third party server?
Absolutely. So that is actually an excellent question. For Benchmark Email, that is actually what we do. We provide email marketing as a service. So you can create regular newsletters with our service, or you can also create these, you know, these customer journeys through automations. I would love to say we're the only service that does that. Of course, we're not. There are other services out there. Some for, depending on the level of automation you need, there's ones that really integrate with, you know, your e-commerce sites and with other platforms. And CRMs, there's other that are just very simplistic to just email marketing itself. we stand right in the middle to where we have a hefty number of integrations with e-commerce, landing page, splash page type sites, and so forth. But yeah, I mean, it is something that I believe there are some email automations that you can plug into your Gmail, but the ones that you really want to work for on your business, I would suggest looking for a more robust platform for that.
Got it. And so this first automation journey that we're going to talk about is the welcome journey. Can you talk to us about kind of what that journey looks like?
Totally. So the welcome journey is the first journey I highly recommend any business should have. If you have a sign-up form on your website, no matter where that is, if someone's subscribing to your blog, if you have a sign-up form on your Facebook page and someone has liked your page and then they want to subscribe to receive your newsletters and deals, the welcome journey, a lot of people, again, they tend to think, oh my goodness, now I've got to create, you know, these 10 different emails. But a welcome journey can be a simple email, which is doing the goal of welcoming your new subscriber. Mm. It's as easy as setting up a automation to where as soon as somebody is added to that new list, you have a welcome email thanking them, telling them the benefits of why they signed up, reminding them that. And we highly suggest to have a call to action to start that engagement from the very beginning with that new subscriber. Another tip that we can give for welcome journeys is try to have a welcome journey per channel.
Okay.
Meaning if you have a sign-up form on your blog and then a sign-up form on your Facebook page and a sign-up form you know, from when somebody downloads a PDF, have a different welcome journey, that welcome email that adapts to what they signed up for, right? I mean, it's easy to set that up, so why not make it personalized to that experience?
That makes sense. So beyond the welcome journey, is that typically just a one email cadence that goes as soon as they performed whatever action that you were trying to get them to take, and then that welcome journey is just typically one email, or is it usually more than one step?
Yeah, you know, some marketers tend to go a little bit more than that. I don't recommend doing that. I prefer each journey to have a goal and a purpose. If you're setting up a welcome journey, create it to where it's just doing that one purpose. It's welcoming your subscriber. Achieve that goal. And then, like I was saying, you can add additional actions to where, like, okay, now that this person is no longer a brand new subscriber, let's move them to this other list, which you can move them to your interested list, in which you're trying to gauge the interest of the subscriber and set up a whole new journey for them.
Got it. Okay. So there's the interest journey. And before that, you had mentioned a follow-up journey. Are those kind of one and the same?
Yeah. So they're both follow-up type journeys. The interest journey, you're trying to gauge the interest level of your new subscriber, right?
Okay.
So, as you know, let's say that you have a PDF that someone downloads, or again, you know, the example from the Facebook, you know, you may have people that subscribe, but they just subscribe because let's say that they're doing some research and you have some cool data that they want to learn from, and they're subscribing to just download that data, right?
Yeah.
But then, of course, you're in business, so you're probably offering a product or service. So that's where your interest journey can come along. And you start gauging the interest by maybe setting up a series of emails talking about the downloadable thing that they just downloaded, you know, the benefits of it, what it is. And based on the engagement of the emails you send, you can track and see who opened that, clicked on links, and therefore start to create forks throughout that road to start separating. These are your engaged potential buyer subscribers, and these are the unengaged subscribers, which you can set them in a totally different bucket or list.
Got it. And then obviously you're feeding the more engaged subscribers content like your case studies and obviously trying to push them deeper into your funnel.
Exactly. It's creating that choose your own adventure story. As they move along, you're allowing your subscriber to choose based on their behavior what path they're going to go down. If they're more engaged, you may have a path that kind of leads more towards that sale. If they're less engaged, you may have a different type of path that maybe even tries to re-engage with them or has a totally different strategy for it.
Got it. This next journey that we're going to talk about is the abandoned cart journey. Talk to us a bit about this one.
Totally. So the abandoned cart journey, this was one that it really blew me away. I recently did some research in regards to, you know, why do buyers abandon cart? And believe it or not, I think it was over 40% of the reason as to why they abandoned cart was because of unexpected costs for shipping or taxes and things like that. The other reason that we saw is because just the shopping process was too complicated, meaning it was too many steps or not clear, or it just seemed like, you know, there was going to be an add-on, whatever that could be. So, you know, having a good abandoned cart strategy, meaning in your purchase process, try to get that email right away. If you notice, there's a lot of sites out there, they barely even let you kind of go through without at least getting that email first. Because as soon as you get that email, if they abandon cart at any time, you have a reason and a way to get a hold of them and try to follow up with them. And hey, if it was the shipping that really bother them, can you expense that? Can you just say, you know what, free shipping, one-time deal, and so forth? And believe it or not, it can really help you increase sales.
Got it. Okay, so this next one, we're going to talk about the appointment journey. Talk to us about this one.
So appointment journeys works really well when it comes down to services, you know, such as if you're a consultant, my goodness, if you are a dentist or any type of consultant type service that you may provide, you know, having that that easy access to being able to set up an appointment can really help you. So, you know, creating a journey that's based on a date, I think car dealerships are also very well known for this, right? When you buy the car, you go in and they have that purchase date. And within a couple months, 6 to 8 months, you get that first email. Hey, it's time for a oil change, a checkup, tire rotation, yeah, and so forth. And the benefit of that is, you don't have to remind a sales rep to schedule that call, to do an email, to blah, blah, blah. You already set up the process once. And, you know, this whole thing about setting up the customer journeys, the benefit of it as well is once you set it up, you're setting up a standard. So think of it this way, like something to avoid is don't try to automate too soon. Get a proven process that works. So if you see yourself sending that same email every week or every other day or whatever that is the perfect type of email to automate. So the appointment ones are perfect for that because it's the similar type of email, right? Yeah. You're scheduled for oil change, you're scheduled for the appointment, yada, 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 follow up, click here, and so forth. So it creates that standard and it allows you to see, does this work and how can you improve it once you're seeing a sample size of this email has gone out to 500 people and the click rate is now going down. Is there something I need to change? If you're just sending out one-to-one emails, you may not notice those patterns and therefore be missing out.
Got it. Okay, so this last journey we're going to talk about, Daniel, is an event-type journey. Talk to us about this one.
So the event-type journeys are for the sales guys out there. You know, for those going to trade shows and things like that. I'm not going to as many trade shows as I was, but back in the day, I mean, every single month, I had a new trade show that I was going to. And, you know, you collect so many business cards, and then you kind of sit there, and you're having to reinvent the wheel each time and creating, you know, trying to figure out, you know, what emails can I send to try to engage and this and that. Again, once you have that, you know, kind of a proven process, of course, per trade show, you may need to make minor changes. But overall, the messages that you send to try to sell your business or service is going to be very similar. So, you know, I think it's easier to have that proven process once and then making the small adjustments per trade show as need be, rather than having to reinvent the whole wheel. So we highly recommend to have an event type journey. You can even create emails before the event and after. So, you know, if you get the list of attendees or if you know of certain people that are going, if you want to invite your own prospects to the event, it's a perfect way to kind of standardize that. And again, if you do a lot of events, it will save you a lot of time. Instead of having to reinvent, you're just making minor changes.
I love it. Daniel, is there, if there's somebody listening to this and they have any questions about the six journeys that we've just talked through, what's the best way for them to get in contact with you? And then also, how can they learn more about Benchmark Email?
Totally. So to contact me, they can contact me via email, Daniel.miller, at benchmarkemail.com. When it comes down to automations, we actually have what we call Automation Friday. Every single Friday, we have a group. It's free for anybody to join, in which we simply talk automations. We obviously use the Benchmark email platform to go over how to create some and so forth. But the good news is even if you're not using Benchmark email, the tips and suggestions that we talk about in these groups, it can be used anywhere else, because we mainly talk about strategies, like how can we automate if I send an email out and they don't open it and I want them to click on it and they don't do that? How can I move them down those milestones? What is the best strategy of doing that? And it's not just us giving the suggestions. We try to make it really interactive with the audience that joins, to kind of share their experience, their tools that they use. And the bottom line is we're trying to promote automation because we see the power that it really has.
Got it. I love it. Daniel, this has been fantastic. I really appreciate your time today. Where can they go to learn more about the sessions that you guys do each week?
Totally. So if they just go to benchmarkemail.com, they'll be able to see there within our blogs. We talk about our Automation Fridays, as well as, you know, if there are good feedback that we get in there, we try to create somewhat of a monthly blog with kind of a recap of our group efforts there.
Awesome, Daniel. Well, thank you so much for your time today. This has been fantastic. I really appreciate it.
Thank you, James.
If you're a B2B marketer, we want to feature you on sites like Huffington Post, Social Media Examiner, and Chief Marketer. Every week, we send out a question related to B2B marketing. We use the responses to those questions to fuel the content we write for really popular websites. So head over to sweetfishmedia.com/questions and sign up today.
Thank you so much for listening. Until next time.